Welcome everybody here to your Bigpoint Battle coverage. I am TobiWan, your host as always for the Bigpoint Battle live stream. Of course, there is another host as well. You could check him out. It is joinDOTA streaming on a couple of the other matches. But if you want to check out all those details, head yourself over to joinDOTA.com and you'll see who is streaming what match from every single competitive tournament all throughout the Dota 2 scene. Well, right now we want to focus on this one. 2,000 euro prize money up for grabs, and the teams which have qualified over the last 2 days now have a chance to face out through the round of 16 and find their way through in best of three matches all the way to the grand final tomorrow night to see who takes the largest chunk of that 2,000 away. Will it be one of these two teams right now? It could be DD Dota. It could also be NextKZ. Who will it be? Let's find out. Time for draft time. Time for draft time. And it's also time to welcome in my co-commentator. Join me from Canada. It is Clairvoyance Man. How are you doing tonight?
Hello. I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing well, man. I'm doing well. I've been feeling a bit down the last couple of days, or I should say the last week or so. But you know what? There's always a cure to sickness. It's called good Dota. Yeah.
Good Dota, huh? That's a hard one to find, in my personal opinion. However, I guess to each his own on that one. Regardless, we see, as you say, DD versus NextKZ, and I also am very, very delighted to see NextKZ entirely because every single time I've seen these guys, I mean, once again, they've been consistently together for over a year now. I mean, of course, a couple of roster changes here and there, but NextKZ has the title still alive. And every single time they've played, I've seen them pick this two dual core lineup. I mean, not two dual cores, just a dual core lineup where they take two very strong hard carries. And I've seen them do a multitude of different things with it. They've countered Batriders with it by forcing him to jump on one and kill it with the other. They've simply just muscled through with very strong carries like PL, Lifestealer, which is still in the pool, of course. And this game, they're doing it differently, so I'm curious to see how they're going to pan it out, because the Magnus gets picked up now, the Bane as well as the Gyro. Surprising to see that the Rubick doesn't get picked up as a counter, but of course, this is Go Black we're talking about on the draft, so we'll have to see.
Yeah, I'm actually interested to see how Goblack's going to do this one, because you're talking about NextKZ's history, and I kind of want to talk a little bit about Goblack's history as well as DD's history. Now, DD's history, we know with Sochka, Bucking Mad, as well as Funzy, like, these guys have been around for a very, very long time. They were actually at TI2, and they played a very, very, what was, and always has been their style, a very passive, calculated kind of style. And that's why I'm interested, like, that's the reason why I chose DD to cast out of all the teams. I'm interested to see how they're now going to play up with the Russians. So you're taking Goblack and you're taking, like, a player like Silent. So you're taking in two players who are used to playing in a very teamfight-orientated lineup. And they muscle through. They're actually, like, I always felt like Goblack was a little bit more like NextKZ than he would have been like DD. That's why I feel like they've got a little a very interesting combination here with Goblack as well as the French.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting indeed, as you say, because one of the funny things about Goblack before he left Empire was there were a couple pro players who were telling me how he was kind of just quote-unquote crying to them because he was losing a lot of games on Empire. As you know, Empire had like a kind of a loss streak just before their departure. Goblack was apparently going telling people that these Russians I'm playing with, I can't stand it because all they want to do is they just want to keep diving and diving and diving and they just throw the game. So yeah, it's good to see that he found the crew that, as you say, is calculated, somewhat passive, but safe style of Dota, one that secures the victory. Mm-hmm. And speaking of securing the victory, DD on their third pick, I'm smelling a Templar Assassin. I mean, I feel like it's going to be a Clockwork. For some odd reason, Toby, there's three purple heroes in the pool, and I say Templar Assassin has to be picked here for the fourth purple hero.
Really? That's your logic, man?
See this? Yeah, man. Purple heroes all the way.
At this point, you at least get your mid-solo, but Puck will be the man that's taken. Templar Assassin up against the Magnus to just so many other heroes. Like, even Queen of Pain and Puck being in the pool, I don't think your purple strategy is going to work there when you get a better counter. And that gives them more teamfight control.
That's true, absolutely. But to be fair, blue is essentially a shade of purple, right? Yes, please?
See, this isn't a good thing to ask me, man, because as a kid I was actually diagnosed as colorblind.
Oh, dear. Oh, well, you know what? Let's just assume we're right just to save time. Excellent. Moving on with life.
Just to make you feel better about the whole thing, as a kid I was colorblind, but when I got tested again when I was like 16, I was actually fine. So yeah, go figure that one.
Oh, which colors were shifted for you?
I don't even remember now. It was just too long ago. So I was just like, yeah. But yeah, my body fixes itself. It's great. Freaking regenerating, man.
Excellent.
All right, let's look at the rest of our draft though, man, because I'm looking at NextKZ with the SD, Darkseid, and Mag. I'm already feeling nice set up with the SD, but nothing that's going to really shut down that gyro apart from like the Magnus RP. If that gyro gets a BKB, I'm not feeling the magic right now from NextKZ that's able to control him, especially with the Bane already picked up by DD.
Yeah, I would say in terms of disables and controlling the heroes, crowd control in general, DD's definitely got the upper hand. Of course, NextKZ with the disrupts, the purge, and the Darkseer vacuum, which is very potent on its own. I mean, the hero as a whole. Even factoring in all the damage as well as the slow pulls, stuns, DD definitely have the upper hand. You know, you got the Bane, you got the Puck. Both heroes come with some sort of sleep, silence, disables, with stuns. And Gyrocopter, of course, that powerhouse hammer that hits everything on the in the teamfight. And it's interesting to see that both teams have decided to opt to take out Leshrac as well as Lina against each other. Because as we know so well, the Bane, Lina, Leshrac, or the Shadow Demon, Lina, Leshrac combo, it could very well work.
But that's fine for DD. Like, I've seen Goblack do this before. Like, he bans out the Lina, they may have taken out Leshrac, but he'll just pick up the Jakiro.
Ah.
Because he loves that hero. He absolutely loves that hero. But normally when he's coupling out with something else like the Magnus or a Darkseer, but in this scenario, he doesn't have that option. There's no team fight pull control.
That is interesting to see indeed. I'm very curious as to see whether he's actually going to go for the Jack. If he does take the Jack, what's going to happen is they're going to have ridiculous amounts of team fight. To the point where I say there's a Darkseer on and a Magnus on the other team. But it might actually be enough to just muscle your way through the teamfight powers known as Darkseer and Magnus. And as I say, that Phantom Assassin gets picked up. I'm not too sure if this is a wise choice, but this is definitely something that they've practiced under the scenes while in their scrim matches. So
They've done this one publicly as well, because I've been casting those cards a little bit of late. Yeah, they love, they actually combined it up with the Magnus because they love using the Empower buff up. On the PA, so you get a high damage dealing item very early on, so man is just free farming it up. You leave the mag in the mag solo mid, PA farming it up, and then you just come in, and once the mag gets the RP, you blink in, and if you get like one like cleave crit, almost everyone is dead instantly. It's brutal, especially when you're then going to add an iron shield on top of that one, and the vac pull in, so there's even a longer control period of time coming out from NextKZ. All they need right now is basically an AoE stunner to join their fold, and they've got it down pat. And that's just one support stunner, which could come from anybody. It could even be Sven if we wanted to.
It very well could be. But I personally feel like they actually need something that's ranged just to keep the PA at line on bait. Because if we look at the lanes, Magnus will be taking up the mid roll. Darkseer potentially to the long lane, but against the Bane babysit, it won't be very successful. So I would say it would be probably going to the jungle. As the Storm Spirit gets picked up now, DD's lineup, yeah, they're very clear as to what they want to do also. I mean, that's probably going to be...
What are you feeling?
It's going to be an aggressive tri-lane now that I look at it again.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. When you get a Storm and a Puck together, the Puck long lane up against NextKZ's lineup, I don't see it surviving long.
No, that would definitely be no bueno. So, against the PA... If they want to do this, once again, it's always so hesitant to see an aggressive tri lane that's not fully geared towards just dishing out massive amounts of damage as well as a whole bunch of stuns. Like, I feel like going aggressive against even heroes like PA, who can just farm from a long range and just leech EXP in the worst case scenario, you really have to dominate. And I'm just not sure if a support like Bane, I mean, it's fantastic, no doubt, one of the best supports in the game. But I'm not sure if you want to opt for something like Bane plus one, as opposed to taking something like, say, Undying, who can just muscle through and just tank tower and tank damage and still come out ahead. They need that difference.
They probably thought the NextKZ was going to be something like some kind of ranged damage or even like Nakes, and then the Enfeeble would have come into play, because then they could have dived it up. But they don't get that. Lion's the last pickup, so we at least get our stunner. Not an AoE stunner as such, but he does have a Lion stun, so that works. And of course the burst damage if you can catch just one hero out.
That Finger of Death, man. 1,000 cast range. Oh boy. Sometimes at nighttime, you know, you're trying to farm at a lane and all of a sudden big red zap comes and hits you and you die and you're just wondering what the hell just happened. Undying, there it is. So they're going to go aggressive tri-lane. Yeah, this is the way they want to muscle through. They say, no PA, we don't want to give you any levels, we don't want to give you any farm, any space. And with the Lion pickup, it looks very, very vague and very, very hazy for NextKZ now, because Lion, once again, a great stunner and great disables. But he is a support hero who needs levels. He just does not have that much assets when it comes to low level. His movement speed is slow, his armor is not that high, his base damage certainly is not the best, and his attack animation in general, it's just not what you want as an ideal tri-lane support. So we'll have to see.
Man, you're going to love this. NextKZ. Oh, no. They're switching it up. I actually thought they'd leave the Darks here on the top lane just to screw with DD's lineup. But they're going to switch it around. So Mantis is still down here on the bottom lane. And they're going to run the two supports. So it'll be Reeves as well as the stand-in cart supporting Stalcat up on the top lane as the Darkseer.
Oh, Toby, that is brilliant. This is NextKZ doing their homework and saying, no, we're going to adapt. We're not going to follow the traditional gameplay of sending Sat Darkseer to the long lane. This is actually as easy and simple as it looks from the spectator point of view. It's always very, very hard to break your standard order of procedures. And props to NextKZ for doing this. This is a very, very smart move because all of a sudden now, if you get your lane pushed, your aggressive tri lane, it might not do as much. I mean, you might be able to farm, but you won't be able to stop the pulls, and that's going to come into a big play.
And this is going to be, going to enjoy watching the battle in the bottom lane too now between Bucking Mad, who surprisingly too is going to be taking up the hard carry role for his team. So he's going to take the Storm Spirit down towards the bottom lane, which puts Silent onto the Gyro. Soshka taking up support Bane. I know he's been doing that role a hell of a lot, but I would have been actually expecting Funzy to be on the safe lane, knowing how he loves to do that with his lone Druid Bear, but in this scenario, not going to happen. He gets to go one-on-one with Whatafucker in the middle lane. And you're actually already seeing a rotation from NextKZ. Yeah. They've given up on the top lane. They see the Gyro up here. Maybe they thought it was going to be a defensive tri lane. Thought it was going to be the Puck up on top lane. But then they saw the Storm on the bottom lane and the Puck in mid lane and said, well, okay, this isn't what we wanted.
No, certainly not. And both teams are actually being very smart about this. They're adapting. Both teams are actually adapting really well. And NextKZ, they have a clear plan. They actually want to dodge the aggressive. So with that, the smoke rotation, is it going to get a kill? I do not believe that it will. However, it'll certainly put DD on their feet. As the Darkseer is getting zoned out at the top lane, the PA will have a slightly easier room. And as I say that, there's not an engagement.
A three-man decay. At this point, Goblack says, you can't kill me, but I can most definitely kill you. He's chasing down the SD, who doesn't have disruption. He's already used it. Now they're going to turn around and help out Funzy a little bit more. I'm pretty sure Goblack only wants to go for another hit, but he's just taken out. He's taken out the salve of the SD at least.
Yeah, I actually think he could have killed the SD there, because after that decay spam, the stun as well as the slow from PA and Lion was casted on somebody else. And his decay was coming up in 4 more seconds. And Undying, one of the reasons why he's so strong is, yeah, while he steals strength, he has 310 base movement speed. Whereas the Shadow Demon sitting at 295, he was not going to run away from Goblack for another 10 seconds. So,
little bit of trouble for Stalcat up here on the top lane. He's nightmared up. They're going to go into a Rocket Barrage. This should be first blood right now with Stalcat. He was trying to interrupt the pull to the top lane. At the end of the day, he got caught out. Wasn't the best coupling of skills, using Nightmare just to set up a reposition as opposed to the Rocket, which was just not going to hit in time because of the Surge. There's still DD first blood on the top lane. That's dual lane up against the Darkseer too.
Yeah, certainly the dual lane is paying off. I'm wondering if Sokshka is going to keep doing what he does at the top lane, or if he's just going to start rotating and kind of stay off the map just to put unknown pressure. And it seems like this Darkseer, this is actually not going to work out very well for NextKZ anymore, because instead of forcing three heroes to be invested on one hero like Darkseer, now they're just investing two. And the Darkseer knows he can die again. And he's actually moving a little bit too far up, but there's creep support, so I feel like he's safe for now.
Yeah, he knows Silent's not going to go back past that Iron Shell. The biggest problem he's still got is just the fact that Soshka is capable of doing exactly what he's doing. Like, you want to surge away, and like, where's your Nightmare going to come? Like, you try and surge, and now you're gone. Reed's getting pulled back in on the bottom lane, already being decayed, so Mantis wants to try and initiate. Oh, wow, that disruption. I think it went on the wrong target there, so the Hex follows up on Bucking Mad. Already, Goblack got the kill out in Reeves, and is going to move straight over towards Mantis. He's got Blink in 4 seconds, and that's the reason why SD's trying to get a little bit more space with the decay and the last right attack by Storm Spirit. Bucking Mad is able to get the kill on the bottom lane. This Undying is just destroying this aggressive tri lane for NextKZ, and we're going to go top lane again too. Nightmare, he'll turn up at the same time. The Rocket's then going to hit Darkseer, tri-surge away, but the Rocket Barrage has a lot of damage already to get the kill out in the Darkseer, and then follows up on Reese. Mantis comes towards the top lane, throws out the Stifling Dagger on Silent. While he'd like Silent, he's not going to reach up to him in time, maybe with a blink, but no, still not enough movement speed. He doesn't have boots, and there's already boots up on the Gyro. Cannot chase.
Absolutely. 4-0 in 3 minutes and 45. Gyro with the highest CS as well as 2 assists on him. This is really not looking good for NextKZ, not only because they're losing every single lane, but also the demonstration from the last events kind of just showed that they're not up to their A game right now. And this Gyro is actually going to get zoned out for a little bit. But even with these rotations from the supports, he's done his damage. So now that this Storm Spirit's going to be kicking in with the mana boots at 4 minutes, I really fear for a snowball effect kicking in against NextKZ very soon.
Mm-hmm. I really do like this. As I said, like in the very, very start of the broadcast, like I wanted to watch DD play because I wanted to see how they were looking just before the TI qualifiers come up on Monday. And this is a team which I'm feeling has managed to gel. Like, they're not being pressured too much by NextKZ, so we can't say this is the be-all, end-all of Alakazam. But could definitely say, like, they're fine in the move, but they're not really being upset by it. Like, NextKZ's early rotation, making the decision then to move their lanes wasn't really that difficult, and they still managed to get it to bend their way. And they find this nice level of, like, mixed aggression plus winning lanes. It's a nice combination. I like to see how this goes up against... maybe if they get through the next round. Of course, this is obviously a best of three, and we can't count out NextKZ, but I would really like to see like what this strat would do up against a top team like Team Liquid or Na'Vi.
Most certainly. Just before I go on about something else, is Alakazam a Pokemon by any chance?
Yes, but yes. Alakazam is his secondary name.
Oh, goodness gracious. You already got the details pat down, huh?
Well, yeah, if I remember correctly, Alakazam is he's a psychic Pokemon.
Yes, I know that much. Excellent. Woof. Good thing. A little bit of engagement going down at the mid lane. What the fuck? I think he's going to go down because Funzy... Oh, no. Funzy, you had him with the coil.
He's going to do it, though. There goes your dream call. He kind of realizes he's coming too close towards the tower. He needs one more orb, so face shift buys him the time to do so. That shockwave, however, the quick silence Starcat will take his life. Maybe not. Quick bottle charges. And he surge just wore off, so he cannot chase down Funzy.
Oh man, that was an extremely close call, Toby. If he just made one more mistake there, oh man, that would have been a very, very embarrassing feat. But he pulled it off. Funzy decided to not show his back, show up in the front, of course. And I almost mentioned a French joke there, but I guess that's not really appropriate right now.
I don't really know what makes it a French joke. Anyway, Mana's getting rocketed on the top lane as well as brain sapped out. Small amount of vision given by that rocket when it came in, so just harassment damage. But you notice NextKZ, now 4 heroes moving up to the top lane. They've completely abandoned the bottom. And Stalcat, say hello to the Bane. Bane's got the high ground right now, so he might just nightmare this one up. And we've seen this before. Golbat's going to come over. He's got a Tombstone too, which he'll probably throw down once he realizes how much is here, but the disruption goes up from the SD. Which really did disrupt it. Nice double stun. Need a follow-up from this one. The Tombstone will drop down finally. And in comes Magnus. Look for that RP. Skewers up two. RP's on two of them too. Man, it's a quick jump in. Sound very low on life. Funzy gets the silence off, but then he's hexed up. Reeves, not caught out by that. Follows up with his own stun. Puck, quick phase shift. He can't get himself out of this one. Even with the one charges, maybe he can. Dream Coil throws it out. A quick stun. He's still got an orb up his sleeve. It manages to actually dodge off the stifling dagger, but he cannot dodge the rest of damage coming off from NextKZ. And they finally get a bit of a fight that goes their way.
Yeah, and a very well-needed exchange indeed. DD going a little bit out of bounds and kind of overextending a little bit. No vision once again, fighting on their side of the map. But at the same time, I believe they got a kill out of that, at the very least. Or was it just a...
No, they didn't get anybody.
They didn't get anybody?
Unless it was... I don't know, SD stayed alive to that one threaded line. Yeah, they didn't get a single kill out of that.
Oh man, that's really not good for them.
Oh no, I am corrected. I am corrected by myself. Gyra killed off Shadow Demon.
Okay, good.
Then PA got a double and Darkseer got one.
Yeah. Yep, so it's going to be looking good for PA for sure. Although he is obviously having a very hard game at this point in stage. The Shadow Demon, however, he's level 3 right now at 7 minutes, 8 minutes into the game. And DD, they're not looking to stop this aggression anytime soon.
In fact, I'm watching Bucky Mad enjoying it right now on the bottom lane. There's a TP going to come down. There's going to be looking for a denial on the tower, but a Starcat, Bucky Mad, he jumps in to get the last hit in the tower. Did not want to have that denied, and now he's going to TP himself out of safety. There's no level in back from Darkseer, so he cannot interrupt it. In the meantime, Silent does get a kill on the top lane on Lion. The Tombstone looks like it was dropped to help him out too. I don't know if you're watching that top engagement, if you're watching the play on the bottom.
Oh yeah, I was actually watching the bottom engagement there.
I have to watch the bottom again too, because Starcat up against a DD Funzy, and he's got an ultimate up his sleeve. He doesn't even need the ultimate. With the extra sound, well, okay, he didn't need the ultimate, but he's going to use it nonetheless.
Yeah. Funzi, he's definitely not taking any shortcuts. He's trying to play everything. He's trying to guarantee everything. Even at the mid lane, I saw he's trying to play it safe a little bit too calculated, perhaps. I'm not too sure how to give him the benefit of the doubt on that one, but regardless, he's getting the kills where he needs them, so it's fine. Oh, I think the Magnus overextended a little bit.
Yeah, nope. But he's got Skewer. He does still have RP up his sleeve too, as Poxy on jump in, but the silence is there. A quick one charge, but it's not enough. Not even with an extra bottle and banners. He can think about jumping that with Bucking Mad and low mana, but not with Funzi there.
Mm-hmm. Definitely not with Funzi there. And the map control, if we look at it 9 minutes into the game, 10-3, is going entirely in favor of DD. Not because they have so many towers on the board, although they have two, and that's good in itself. Mm-hmm. But oh, Funzi's gonna get engaged on.
Yeah, quick start in the middle lane, and this should be level 6 for Reeves if they can get the kill. Maybe they can't. He's able to phase shift and also join himself away to safety. So many heroes being committed to get these kills, it's just not working for them. Also, I give apologies to the guys on DOTA TV who didn't have a... Gold Black. Smack bang in the middle of them, drop down the tombstone, lose his life almost instantly. He couldn't get it to KO off in time, so he didn't get that bonus life points up and running. And then he also feeds the tombstone to NextKZ.
Feeding the tombstone. A lot of dead bodies.
Yes, but hello to the people on DOTA TV. My apologies, the microphone wasn't turned on due to the, Staff Cup. Sound's also gone on the top lane. Easy skewer, and Magnus gets the kill on Silent.
Yep, four heroes rotating to the top. Of course, the Shadow Demon wasn't exactly involved on the kill. But now the pings are coming up for the Invis rune at top, and depending on who gets this rune, if both teams are watching, as they should because they both have wards there, there should be no activities.
Funzi's got it. What a fucker. Silenced up instantly, and then just a quick orb away from... Thought that one was going to be blown, but he popped the Invis rune. Now the Fiend Script's up on Magnus. There's also the old one from Puck that's going to be here, but it catches... What? No one out of all of that looked right, but wasn't right. Zoshka able to get a brain sap out, so he does kill up the Magnus at the end of the day. Well, looks like we're going to see the SD support get picked off by Funzi. Stalcat going to TP on the high ground. There's nothing that's going to stop him from doing such a thing. But I don't think DD cared. They're going for the tier 1 tower in the mid lane, but that Dream Call looked definitely right.
Yeah, no, you know, for sure. They will get the tier 1 tower at mid. But really, Funzi, that's... I don't think there was an excuse on that one.
Reeves,
he should have been able
Reeves
to know that.
Gonna gank him. Up. He needs that Hex. Bucky Man's got jump. He didn't jump, which means Finger of Death.
Ah. As the Storm Spirit says, I blew it. He dies to the Finger of Death.
It wasn't even the Storm Spirit that blew it. It was Lion, Storm Spirit. Mm-hmm. He's claiming it for the other hero, man.
That's just the Storm Spirit moxie.
Hmm. Well, if you wear a hat that big, you got to have some kind of big head. Man. Still, good job by Soshka during that middle engagement before. The fact he managed to get that Fiend Script off and force an SKZ to try and come and engage. Like, if the Dream Call was there, that would have been so much easier. But he had to do it the hard way. Got a bit of a lucky, skewer up to that high ground, so he had a lot more room to play around with.
Yeah, absolutely. And once again, they really did pick up where they're falling short, of course, with the coil missing. Regardless, got the kills, got the tower, and they're really in a good position entirely because the Storm Spirit is so farmed that once he finishes his Orchid, which looks like that's what it's going for, mm-hmm. he's going to be able to pick off any hero essentially, just because all the heroes are so low level and rely on casting spells just to get away. PA, he's got to blink out. Magnus, he's got to skewer out. Darkseer, you have to vacuum the target and you gotta surge, and of course, Lion and Shadow Demon. As I say that, top lane.
Yeah, Magnus getting initiated on. Already silenced up by Funzi. There's no blink possibility to even the creep wave when he's left, but it was a quick and easy kill with that blink dagger up on Puck. He's just, too easy to jump yourself in and out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I forgot to mention that blink dagger is up online on the Puck now. He got around 12 minutes.
Yeah, it was
not
around
too
that.
Shabby. Not too shabby indeed.
Smoke gank time. In this case, he can't find anybody. There's two in the mid, and that's probably where they'll end up going, but Silent is doing the very wise thing of just remaining, hidden on that bottom lane. Even then, he's also got, a Shadow Armlet, so... In three under a gold, he'll have his full Shadow Blade and can move around with that Invis, but for now, he can also just go Invis, and I don't think NestKZ's got anything to reveal him. Nope, no dust, no nothing. So
even
if they do find him, they won't kill him. Top lane Starcat's been brain sapped. Fiend Script as well. Wow, that's some serious commitment. And the double TP's coming in. One's going to be cancelled, and Manus wants to go on Bucking Mad, but that secondary TP that was cancelled, now it's going to be Bucking Mad being initiated on by Manus, but what a fucker, he wants an RP, and they all split. Wonderful split there by DD. They knew it was coming. And they were actually in a horrible position at the time. The Waterfucker couldn't find the opening. He's currently being chased by a rocket, but that's not going to make any difference with this one. DD aren't going to follow him into the base.
No, and yeah, that engagement kind of looked awkward. It was kind of just the Magnus sitting in between four heroes going, well, which way do I go, guys? And he faked the skewer animation a couple of times, but to no avail, DD was able to survive the whole ordeal. And let's see if NextKZ are able to survive this one, because DD is coming to go for a flank.
Oh, Funzy. Oh. Trouble in middle lane. Stun Finger of Death already kills him up before this fight can begin. Bucking Mad jumped in, but he doesn't really have a lot of mana to play around with. Manus wants another kill. He's got that stifling dagger up on the Bane, but he couldn't jump in close enough. And that's that Iron Shell combination we're talking about on Mantis. The high level of damage he does the second he comes in. Not to mention he wants that level 11, then we're going to take into account the coup de grace.
The coup de grace. Goodness gracious, what a smooth pronunciation.
I actually had a team called coup de grace back in the day.
Is that French by any chance?
Yes.
Okay. Je ne parle pas français. May.
And you now know more French than I do.
No, I'm Canadian, man. That's my second language. I gotta know a couple words.
I thought there's like a whole bunch of French Canadians.
Yeah, I'm one of them.
Sweet.
that didn't fly as well as I'd hoped it to. But that's okay. It doesn't matter because DD is going to push the mid tower now. Going for the tier 2. As for NextKZ, they're not prepared at all. And you know what? I just noticed this Shadow Demon is level 5. In 15 minutes, and he's got no boots. He's actually got in his inventory now, so congratulations, SD. However, that is no bueno. Like, it's just 15 minutes into the game, you lost so many towers, and your map advantage is falling a little bit short. But now I finally remember what I wanted to talk about a little bit, was the whole Storm Spirit build with Arcane Boots. I remember the first person who started this was Chi, actually. God killed them all, when he was on Dare. And it was kind of known to be the G build, where he gets the Mana Boots and then turns it into a Bloodstone. Mm-hmm. It's kind of fallen off now entirely because Orchid just seems to be a more efficient item.
Oh, blink in. Double silence. You might have to wait for it for a moment, man. Starcap, there's your jump in by Bucky Matt, and he goes in for the ST as if life isn't hard enough. And a four-man cooldown hits so damn hard. PA able to get a kill in the middle of all this, but the Phoenix Grip holds the mag out, so there was no possibility for the RP. And now Stalcat and Manus both getting orbed as well as Rifted down. A quick decay from Undying. Able to get one, maybe the final kill. I can't believe that Lion is actually the last hero out of all this to die, but that's all five heroes to NextKZ on the sideline.
As well as the tier 2 tower going down, and man, Toby, I gotta give credit where it's due. Sokshka, he just carried that fight as a whole. He saw the Magnus trying to blink in from a range, and he clicked the Fiend's Grip just before the skewer animation happened. Got him right as the skewer ended and shut down the RP from casting. Very well done by Sokshka. Carried the entire fight, because otherwise, if the RP had went through, three heroes were in that vicinity, and they would have gotten RP'd. With the PA and Darkseer being double-shelled around, they would have all died, guaranteed. And of course, the Bane doesn't really run away from four heroes very fast, so... Very well done by Sokshka. But if I could just reiterate on the point of the mana boots on Storm, if you've noticed the Storm Spirit actually trying to engage a couple of those heroes, you'll notice that Arcane Boots, yeah, while it's a great item in terms of mana supplements, like, Storm Spirit is a hero who needs to attack a lot. Like, he needs to have enough attack speed so he can cast Overload and cast his animations much faster. Mm-hmm. Mana Boots doesn't actually let you do that. And if you also look at his ultimate, it works by percentage. So, I have to say, I've changed my build around ever since, and I personally don't agree with the mana
boots. We'll have to wait a second, man. Mana boots, Storm Spirit's better get a kill right now on Stalcat. Jumps up, jumps down. Puck even throws the ultimate to get the kill.
Mana boots, Storm Spirit indeed does get the kill. And I gotta say, all of a sudden, my opinions changed. Mana boots is the best item on this guy. What the hell am I thinking with my life right now, Toby?
But you are right about it, though, man. Like, you do basically say, like, you've got to get out there and attack a lot faster. But at the same time, it's... Maybe this was the reason why, oh, by the way, bottom lane, is Sarn really going to be able to get a solo kill out in all three of these heroes right now? That, she almost with a flag cannon, he almost killed off Reeves right there. RP Finger of Death, and now it's Mana Boots Storm Spirit, looking for three. Reeves going to TP out one, can he get a kill at least on the Shadow Demon? No, he can't! They both get out to safety. Dear.
See, Toby, if that was a Trez right there, he would have been able to get either another quick off or done enough damage. Come on, oh dear, come on, please.
But it's a trade-off, man. It's a trade-off. Because if you get your mana regeneration of a Bloodstone up even faster, then that's your trade-off. And jumps like that, like, he wouldn't have been able to throw out, like, a secondary Static Remnant during that if he didn't have the mana boots as well. He needed that extra 100 burst back in again. Manus blinks away to safety. Fonzie blinks to chase, but nothing's going to happen in the middle. And, well, maybe it will. Starcat, wow, he really wants this kill. They're going to jump in. And then Fiend's Grip. Soshka's got him. There's a Soul Rip to keep Goblack alive. And a quick SD disruption. Tries to buy some space for Starcat. He's got no Alderman. There's nothing to really help out here apart from, well, stick charges. But then Man's forced to blink away. The Purge goes out and Goblack slowing him down. But they're not finding a kill just yet. Reeds wants one. He is almost baiting himself. He doesn't know the funsy is. Well, he should know the funsy is Invis here. Considering he went Invis in front of them.
I think Funzi could have actually just coiled Reeves there, and that would have made the fight much easier. What would have happened is if he just coiled Reeves and killed him, they could have backed off and probably gone for the tier 2 tower at the top lane. He's being really hesitant with his usage, I feel like. I feel like he's being a little bit too preservative right now, because the way I see it, if you kill the support hero in that scenario, you know, we talked about the Magnus using RP on support heroes sometimes, right, alone, and whether it's worth it or not.
Yeah.
The thing is, if you get an advantage out of it, use whatever you have to do. I mean, you saw at the bottom lane, you saw that gyrocopter getting decimated by three ultimates, right? I mean, of course, not every single ultimate was necessary. However, calling it a waste will be a different context. It will be a different thing in its entirety. And so, I gotta say, while the puck coil is up, he should look to using it as an initiation a little bit more, and he'd be able to garner more kills, favor the map control on their side, and now that it's 20 minutes, they could probably have done Roshan as a result.
Mm. But at the same time, though, like, yeah, sometimes it's hard to make those decisions when you're on the fly, unless you want to go full-out aggressive. But as we were talking about before, like, DD, they never really played that kind of way. And Bucking Mad, like, he's never massively been a huge fan of, like, let's just go dive team fight and try and win this kind of thing. And even, like, we're talking about with Goldblade too, the way he changed his mind. They're gonna attempt Roshan right now, and this is, not going to be the right timing for it. Unless it's just a bait to try and get a kill, at which point they're 100% on the job, because there's T-Warning coming off. The SKZ were already spotted, and yeah, Funzy's going to go in. Dream Call on three, he gets him, and then Storm Spirit in through the side. There's actually four here, the RP, it's actually, never can't get off. Never gonna happen, really, and that's just destroying all of NextKZ. SD is the only one to escape up through the top, and Bane is trying to chase him down. But they'll push it and take the tier 3 tower now, and possibility of the Vrax.
Yeah, I don't see the need to go for Roshan here. If they actually go for Roshan, I'd probably make a French joke right about there. But you know, they're gonna go for the base right here. There's no need to hold back. They know they have huge advantage in terms of gold experience as well as the map positions. Their heroes are ridiculously farmed. And even though this glyph is coming out, once again, there's a level 7 Shadow Demon on the field, as well as a level 9 Lion, who they both have their spells. However, as for base defense, you know, they're not, you know, that's not exactly their field of specialty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this isn't really going to work for them unless they have that. Yeah, it's not even up, man. Blink to a skewer, maybe out of, like, do it, but no, he finds nobody. Blink skewers through, they've already lost their melee racks. Shockwave will push the creep wave out a little bit, or push it in, I should say. Which pulls it away from the range racks. Amandus, well, he sees Goblack, best possible choice, and he gets crit in the first hit in, and now nice ass by Funzy, perfect position. The cooldown comes again, hitting down, but it's just, well, everyone's gone, everyone's calling GG. It's just, even Bane chasing down Waterfucker out of the base, and Darkseid's already back in the well. This first game is over. Third game, NextKZ. It's really hard to say, like, NextKZ got done on the draft. In fact, if anything, it's gonna say they got outlaned.
No, they definitely got outplayed this game. There's no excuses for that one. Their draft was quite solid.
Yep.
Their laning phase was extremely shaky entirely because of the confusing rotations on DD's part. And Goblack, he really kept it together in the early game.
There we go!
Oh dear.
Finally some revenge for NextKZ. Silent goes invis and pucked up basically phase shifts. Oh, maybe not some full revenge. Yes it is! Silent's gonna go down. Starcat and Reeves get to stay alive. It's a small thing. Can they kill off Funzy too? There's no finger. Actually, no, there's Finger of Death. Reeves is trying to wait for that phase shift to go, and now Park. Oh, no. Funzy, don't spoil the fun. It's Bucking Mad coming in, and Storm Spirit actually kills him. It's just. No.
No. Not today, fellas. Not today. Drop a remnant, and he's dead.
They're still not giving up. What? There's a Linker Spear now off from Bucking Mad. There goes the Bloodstone idea. he had the extra cash.
It is a mana boost Storm Spirit, Toby. What can I say? Going godlike in kills, of course, not exactly godlike because he does have deaths, but mana boost Storm Spirit. Very, very, it is very powerful, of course, but once again, I feel like there's just better alternatives sometimes.
Mm-hmm. All right, so game number one's going to be over, guys. Finally, all the players will leave the game, so we'll get our final stat screen. I like how NextKZ were the last ones to leave, so we'll get a fake result coming up on our screen where it'll in fact be showing up as NextKZ wins, but in fact be the dire side. But that's going to be game number one. Remember, if you want to keep up to date with everything which is happening over for the Bigpoint Battle, you can find the link from the tournaments tab over on joinDOTA, or you can go to bigpoint-battle.com and just click on the results, and you'll see what's happening with the grid right now. Obviously, the first games have started off from a lot of the matches, so there's no results in just yet. But we will be having some later night Dota as Team Liquid won't start their round of 16 matchup until 20 CEST, and then we'll probably jump into that round to the quarterfinal matchup of that upper bracket. But for now, though, we're going to follow the winner of this game, which almost looks to be DD right now, because the winner of this game will face up against either Roxkiss or Knights. Those two teams are currently playing it out right now. Who will be the victors of that one? Well, you get to find out if you check out the website, but right now we want to know who's going to win DD versus NextKZ. Will it be over in two, or will we get to come back for a third? Stick around and you'll find out.